performing the research and reaching milestones. There are many aspects which involve preparing a publication and getting it submitted and accepted by a peer-reviewed journal. And I'm going to give a quick overview of all these aspects. And essentially, this slide shows the points that I am going to discuss in this talk. And they deal with preparing a manuscript and having it accepted for publication in a peer-reviewed journal. So these slides were prepared by the staff of the Optical Society, and I'm especially grateful to Alison Taylor for doing this. But in practice, they deal with many aspects which are dealing with any peer-reviewed journal, not only the journals of the Optical Society. And well, the first thing is you're a student, a master student or a doctoral student, search, and at some point you will get results which represent an important milestone in your project, and you want to think about preparing a publication, which is something really fantastic, preparing a publication means writing a manuscript, and then you have to, that's an interplay between some considerations which go beyond reporting about the technical part of your work, and about adapting this initial consideration to the specific features of the journal you want to publish into. And in particular, in this initial considerations of primary importance or the fact that you need to explain to the reader why your work is important, why it is novel. And for doing this, you need to refer to the state of the art in your field and to explain this, the context of your work in view of the existing literature. That's something which takes a lot of time and which takes a lot of effort. So in principle, you can expect that the more senior people in your team will help you about this. However, my advice about this part is that you should not wait to write your manuscript. Of course, when you start your master thesis or your doctoral thesis, you're overwhelmed because there are many new concepts, many new tools that you need to master, and that's really extremely demanding. But don't forget to take a little bit of distance and to be critical about your work. Why are you performing the study that you are performing? How does it compare to what is already known? Are there people who already did the same thing? And in such case, what do you expect to improve? Or is it a totally new idea? And in such case, why is this idea perhaps promising for improving our understanding or for a fantastic technical improvement? So try to to ask yourself this type of questions at a very early stage, because it takes a lot of time to be able to answer this type of questions, and it's totally normal that in the beginning of your doctoral studies you are a bit lost about this. Of course, you need to gather around you a team of co-authors who can help you in the technical work, but also in answering this question. So discuss with your co-authors at a very early stage and see how you can take advantage of their specific competence. And when you get a manuscript, that's also very useful to ask other researchers to give their opinions. Perhaps there are people in your group who did not contribute to the work, but who could ask play the role of pre-referees. Don't forget that if you spend a lot of time digging into some things, there are a number of things which are going to become very obvious to you, but which are not necessarily obvious to a reader. reader. And so getting some feedback from people who were not involved in your study is very useful. And then you will need to, when your results are gathered, you will need to adapt your result and your findings to a particular journal. So for this, I recommend that you you look on the internet, you find for each journal, you find some recommendation, some guide to authors which explain about the particular format which is expected to for a submission. Don't write something too long, be concise. That's there is a balance to find, and pay attention to present and to write very well, or very very good advices. At the end, your work is going to stay in the literature, and if people understand it, if people enjoy reading it, it's sure that it will be more powerful and more impactful. The acceptance criteria for journals, here that's the acceptance criteria for Journal of the Optical Society, but actually they are more or less the same for any peer review journal. And they are of several types. First, you need to identify a journal for which your work is well appropriate. So there are journals which are very generalist, which are usually what we call high impact journal, like Nature, or things like or journals of this type, which are, of course, you have to be ambitious, you have to aim high, but sometimes not too high and not too low. So not every work is suited for Nature. And in such case, it's good to identify a journal where your publication will find its audience. So of course, the impact factor of the journal is important, because unfortunately, there are a lot of people who judge a paper only by the impact factor of a journal. So you cannot totally neglect it, but it doesn't make everything. And in particular, if you publish in a journal where your community never publishes, then your paper is not likely to find its audience and is not likely to get cited and to be impactful in your field. There is, of course, the expectation that your results are new and that they move forward the field, even though there are some journals like Continuum at the Optical Society, there are a few other journals which do not have the requirement of non-incremental work and which essentially expect simply the paper to be technically correct. But most journals expect that there is some novelty in your paper. Then the criteria are also the technical quality of your work. Essentially, you need to get some conclusion that will be really scientifically proven by the data that you will show. And there are some important aspects which are related to the presentation of the work. You need to explain why your study is important, and you need to show your results in a well-written and logically organized manner. What I do with my group, which has been rather successful, is that we are experimentalists, and when we start a new experiment, when the experiment starts to be successful, so that we know that at some point there will be a paper, even if we are not at the point of preparing the paper, then we still prepare a kind of outline without even knowing to which journal we are going to submit. But we start to discuss which figures would be needed. Usually we prepare more figures than we actually use, which does not matter because they can be reused for talks or posters. But we prepare an outline, and this helps us a lot in collecting the right data, because you need to have a logical organization. And if it turns out that when you think that your experiment is finished, you start writing and you need to get back to the lab because you forgot about something which is very important, it's time consuming and frustrating. So we try to anticipate a little bit in advance and to really prepare how we want to tell our story, how we want to tell our message to the reader at a rather early stage. Of course, an important aspect in a publication is to know who are the authors of a publication, and that's usually a very sensitive point, especially for early career researchers such as doctoral students. So the authors should be people who have significantly contributed to the work, to the scientific work, either by conceiving or designing the work, or by analyzing or interpreting the data, or by writing the paper. So that's a requirement which is correct, which is true for any peer review publication. In many cases, it's rather clear-cut. In some cases, it's not so obvious what we call contributing substantially, and that's the reason why it's very important to discuss this with the potential co-authors and to discuss this very openly and in a very professional manner. It's possible, it's usually one finds a good agreement between people. There are a few cases where people disagree, and then it's very important that it is said very clearly, and in particular the group leader can expect to compensate the frustration of those who cannot be satisfied in the next publications. So try to identify the potential co-authors and discuss with them at a rather early stage. Order, you have probably noticed that the order of the authors in the publication varies depending on the field and often depending also on the group. So there are different, from one research field to another and from one group to another, there are different practices which are summarized here. I think that in optics it's rather usual that the one who has done the most of the work is the first author, and that usually the last author is the PI of the study. And finally, be aware that you can only submit your paper when all co-authors agree with the submission, and that in particular, changing the orders of the author after submission, it's something which in principle should not be done or can be done only with permission of all authors. So that's one of the reasons why it's important to discuss it before submitting in a very open manner. Finally, keep in mind that it's really great to be a co-author of a publication, but that it also creates some duties. As a co-author, you are responsible for your contribution in your publication, but you are also responsible for the integrity of the data, of any part of the work, even the work you have not contributed to. And so don't hesitate to ask to your co-authors if you have any doubt or if you fear that there is any misunderstanding, discuss it with your co-authors before submission. There is an aspect that one does not always think about, which are the ethical guideline beyond associated with a publication. Well, first you need, before submitting, you need to obtain the clearances from whoever you need, which always include your co-authors, but in some cases it may be also your research institution or the third party funding body who has been funding the study. You are expected to submit your manuscript to only one journal at a single time. You cannot submit simultaneously to several to several journals. If you, most journals expect that now you declare any conflict of interest, which can be, for instance, if you are patenting the result of your study, if you are funded by a company, or if you are a shareholder of a company which may have commercial interest in your paper, you must declare it. It's very important to give proper credit to the work, and so in particular if you need to cite the text from somebody else, including from that you have taken from another publication, including a publication that you have written, you must do it with crediting properly the publication. So in general, it's recommended to avoid to cite too much, to reproduce too much text from other publication. But if it is very important that you do it within quotation mark and by add a reference to the work that you need to do, even if it is your own work. Similarly, if you want to reproduce a figure that was already present in another publication, you must obtain permission from the authors and from the publisher. And finally, last but not least, it's very important not to forge data. That's perhaps it seems obvious to you, but that's a growing problem in peer review publication, and that's doing this can have really very very important consequences for your career. It's considered as scientific misconduct. Similarly, plagiarism that we were discussing before is also a scientific misconduct. So if you are fabricating data without saying it in a publication, you can be banned from publishing with a given publisher. And in some extreme cases, people have been kicked out of their job for doing this. There is the case where people voluntarily fabricate data, which is really to avoid by all means. But you need also to be careful that you need to be very clear about the data that you are showing. And for instance, if you perform a simulation that you want to include in your paper, make it clear that it is a simulation and not make sure that there is no possible misunderstanding that it could be an experimental result, for instance. And finally, there is something for people who are dealing more or less with biology or biomedicine, which is that there are some principles for animal and human research. So we are at the point where now you have obtained a manuscript and you are ready to submit it for publication. And there are some additional steps that you should be aware of and that you should use in a proper manner. And the first thing is when you will submit to a journal, most of the time, the journal gives you the option to suggest potential reviewers for your papers. And that's something that you should do because you help the associate editor to identify people who will be competent and who will be able to judge your work. So of course, you should not propose people who are closely related to you, so not your present and past supervisors, not people you have collaborated with recently, not family members. It's very welcome if you propose junior scientists, like experienced doctoral students or postdocs. They make very, very good reviewers and they are often more available than the big names who were the leaders in your field. In some cases, you can ask people to not to be reviewers. You should do this if you have really a conflict of interest with people, but don't overdo it. And you have to know that most of the time, the editor who will handle your publication will try to accommodate your request, but they do not have to do so. So in some cases, it's up to them and they don't have necessarily to to proceed with your wishes. Now we have this little cartoon. Once your paper is submitted, you are in a situation where essentially you have to wait. You need to know that the policy about peer review depends on journals. Essentially, the so-called high impact journals do not send every paper to peer review. So that's the case for journals in the Nature or Science family. That's also the case at Optica. For instance, at Optica, only 20% of the papers are sent to peer review, which means that every paper is looked at by at least two members of the editorial board who decide whether the novelty and the impact of the paper satisfy the criterion of the journal, and they may decide not to send to peer review, to reject immediately the paper if they think it's not novel and not impactful enough. And conversely, there are papers, there are journals which send most of the papers to peer review, unless, for instance, the English is very poor or the presentation does not follow the guidelines of the paper. But that provided that the formatting of the manuscript is okay, it will be sent to peer review. The peer review process can be rather long, first because the associate editor has to find people who want to review, and sometimes people don't answer the emails or are too busy, and it can take time. And also sometimes the reviewers take their time to do their report. One should not forget that they are doing this in a volunteer manner. And so most journals have tracking options which enable you to see what is the status of your manuscript. And don't be disappointed, sometimes it can take up to 3 months to receive feedback from your reviewers. Once the report are obtained, the editor who is in charge of your journal needs to make a decision about your manuscript. So this is a simplified representation of what can happen. Essentially, depending on the advice by the reviewers, one can decide to accept the manuscript provided that there are some minor revisions which are implemented, or to encourage resubmission in case there are major revisions, or to reject the manuscript if the manuscript has flaws which are pointed out by the reviewers. There is no clear-cut situation. The editor needs to study the advice by the reviewers in order to make a decision. And so this is simply a simplified diagram. And then it's very likely that you have to deal with the revision of your manuscript. So that's something which is frustrating and which is hurtful. So you need to be aware of this. It's important that you consider that the reviewers are not your enemies. So they, in principle, they provide feedback which aim at for you to improve your manuscript. And so even if at first sight it may be that the reviewer is stupid and that they have not understood what you were willing to say, take a bit of distance. If they are saying this, that's not to hurt you, and it may be because what you have presented is not well presented enough, so that you need to be clearer and to add explanations. When you revise your manuscript, now most journals expect that you write a reply to the reviewers, address all the points made by the reviewer. You It's possible that the reviewer is wrong. It's possible that you do not agree with the reviewer. In such case, say it in a very professional manner and explain your scientific reasoning. But do not be aggressive or do not criticize the reviewers. Keep a collegial tone and be prepared to be perseverant, because it can happen that there are several rounds of reviews that you will have to work on your manuscript several times. There is also the even more unpleasant case where your manuscript is rejected. So it happens to everybody, and it happens quite often. So that's even more frustrating, but in research you need to learn to be resilient and to be resistant to frustration. In case it happens, it's important that you take even more distance and that you see the positive side of this experience, and that you anyway take into account the comments by the reviewers to improve your manuscript in a distant manner, and then you can prepare your manuscript for another journal, but you have not wasted your time because you got useful feedback from your reviewers, even if you are disappointed. And be aware that everybody, including the most well-known scientists, have their manuscript rejected rather often. And so with this, I have finished this quick overview. I think the most interesting will be to see your questions and to see your to discuss with you. And of course, I'm always available for this, so we can discuss now. There is a little bit of time. I will be happy to answer your questions with Slack, and you have my email address on this slide, and you have also the email address of the Optica journal, and so feel free to reach out if you want to continue this discussion. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Natalie, for that talk. It was really interesting, and for all the advice. I'm sure it's very relevant for all of us here who want to publish at some point. So we have a couple of questions. We might have time for one or two. So the first one is, should you contact someone to ask them if they're willing to review your work before asking the journal to consider them?
No, in general, no. So you just propose the names that you think appropriate, and then it may be that the journal will contact them, but not necessarily. As I said, that's the choice of the editor who is in charge of the journal, of your manuscript, to do this. But you don't have to contact people beforehand. And of course, people, the editor is free to take into account your suggestions or not, and the contacted reviewer is free to accept or not to review.
Okay, thank you. So the second question is, what is a good criteria to have when choosing a journal for publishing a piece of work?
Yeah, so I think the first criterion is people from your community who publish in this journal. If your colleagues never publish in this journal, you should a little bit wonder if it's a good idea. I think it's very important that the journal, that the paper finds its audience. Then you need to appreciate how novel and how impactful is your paper. Is it a totally new idea? Is it going to excite a lot of people in your community, or is it more incremental? And depending on this, you can aim very high, or go for a more specialized journal. There are more specialized studies which are still very worth publishing, and which turn out to be very important. I think about appreciating how exciting it is, it's useful to speak with other people in your field. and to see how they react, if they are very enthusiastic, if they are astonished because they had never thought about it, or if they are simply friendly with you, and it can give you some idea. And in principle, speaking with more experienced researchers can help you about this. Then there is a question of should you go for an open access journal or not? Which is, so the problem of open access is that you have to pay. There are a lot of groups who cannot afford it, so that's unfair. On the other hand, if you can afford it, it's it means that your publication will be available to the entire community for free, and it means that it's very likely that it will attract more readers and more interest. So in case your group can afford paying the publication fees, I think it is worth going for open access.
Okay, perfect. Well, thank you very much. I think we have run out of time, but I'll put